Hi, I'm Nick. We're going to be playing some EU4. Now, there was this one particular playthrough of EU4 that I was playing last year. It was going rather well, I thought. But then I got distracted away. And then there were several patches, broke my save, or at least made things work slightly different. And so I thought, why not, if I'm trying to get back into making YouTube videos, make a video of this playthrough. I'm not going to be making a complete record of all this playthrough. I'm not going to be recording every single thing I do, partially because I don't want to be spending all of my time uploading videos, and partially just because it might be boring. But hopefully I can find some kind of highlights reel, or at least bring you in to see all the interesting, exciting bits. So hopefully that will be fun. Now, the particular game that we're going to be playing is to get these three achievements. So we're playing with a custom nation of no more than 50 points, and no more than 3 total development, and we will eventually own and core all of Scandinavia and the British Isles and convert them to Norse. So we're going to be playing Norse, we're going to be trying not to die, and we're going to try to get big and strong and then force the Christians out of our homeland. Now, to do this, I am going to be playing a custom nation in one of the few 1-1-1 options that we have, and the best one that there is, I feel, is Reykjavik. The reason for Reykjavik is that it is 1-1-1, it is close to the New World, so we're going to be colonizing, we're going to get big and strong in the New World, abandon Reykjavik, get a huge empire, and then come and invade. So it's 1-1-1, it's in Europe. The other 1-1-1 options that you could colonize from, for instance Cape Verde, aren't in Europe, and therefore you have to spend points in order to have Western technology. If we want to start with Western technology, we need to start in Europe. Now, the best reason also is that it is Norwegian territory. Norway starts as a junior partner to Denmark, so they can't declare any wars of their own. They can't come and destroy us. And Denmark doesn't care about some little 1-1-1 province in Iceland. They're going to be far too busy fighting other people, and also I don't really think, even if they had nothing else to do, I don't think they'd even care about Norway's province in Iceland. If Norway gets kind of subsumed by Denmark, if Denmark inherits Norway, then Denmark will start caring about Reykjavik. But by then, I'm going to be gone. And also Sweden's going to bash them up anyway. Other 1-1-1 provinces in Scandinavia and the British Isles include the Western Isles, and also some of these, I think, like the Faroes. I don't want to be in Scotland, because the Scots would actually destroy me. So instead, we're going to be in Reykjavik. Now, I'm just going to load my custom nation, which is called Fury, which is apt, given the Odin. Just for fun, led by a woman, a suitably weird Norse name. As you can see, I've mined my heir for points, and have, I guess, the given myself this diplomatic advantage, hopefully it should allow me to rush to colonization, but we can't be certain. We do need 3 admin points because we need to unlock the idea in time to not waste, to minimize the amount of diplomatic points that we waste. Start a duchy because that also saves us on points. Hopefully our heir dies before our ruler dies, but can't be certain. If our heir comes of age, then we can make them a general, and hopefully they die in some battle somewhere. For ideas, I found that development cost is very useful for springboarding. Essentially, we're going to make Reykjavik a much better territory using our early game monarch points, which will then give us enough of an income to support a colony. And once we've gone past the firstly, we will need to abandon Reykjavik before we have 5 provinces in the New World, because otherwise a colonial nation will form and we won't get those provinces ourselves. So we'll be banning Reykjavik, but once we have 2 or 3 provinces in the New World, we should have enough income coming in to support more provinces, and we won't have to rely on Reykjavik's massive COD income, because we will certainly be ramping up the production and base tax of this highly famous COD-producing province. And certainly, we'll be a jewel of Europe by the time we're finished with it. So there's some development cost. The settler increase is just a 0 point thing to start that will be somewhat useful, but I should point out that for most of the game we'll be playing, well, for most of our colonization efforts, we'll actually be playing on 50% colonial maintenance, because the amount of new colonists we get per gold, per unit of colonial maintenance gold, at 50%, relying just on the percentage chance, is a percentage chance of successful colonist, is actually going to be higher than the additional colonists would get from putting the maintenance up and thus getting the settler increase from other things. But it does depend on exactly how many settlers per month increase we have. I in fact have a spreadsheet for that, which we may consult in the future. Core creation costs, last time I was playing, core creation costs really started eating into my budget. The amount of admin points you have to spend in order to core your colonies actually is smaller than coring a province that you conquer, but we are going to need so many of these provinces. We're going to have to colonize so many provinces that the costs add up, and also we're going to have to be coring a lot of provinces that we do conquer from Native Americans, and those will actually be worth more more money anyway. And especially because we'll be at least trying to conquer the entirety of a continent's Native Americans in one go, or at least all of the Native Americans that border each other in one go, so that no one westernizes, and also so that no other European nation gets any of those provinces. We're going to have to want to call them as quickly as possible. Colonial range, we need at least some colonial range to guarantee getting to the New World before everyone else. I've put it in this position because we won't be able to colonize until 9 or 11, Diplo 9 probably. think that's right, but it has been months. I may have forgotten which diplomatic tech is the breakpoint. So arguably we could actually put it here and save on more points. But anyway, some trade efficiency just to bring us in the income, because obviously we're going to be small, we're going to be relying on goods from the New World. Hopefully that will give us a bit of money, but in the long run, obviously money isn't everything, and focusing too much on gold income to the detriment of actually making your nation good at fighting things is not... Because eventually in late game we're going to have enough gold to do everything anyway, but just a little nudge along at the start. Missionary strength, because we're going to be converting a lot of provinces, both in the New World and in the Old World. Just some culture conversion costs, so that there will be lots of rebels. Discipline to help fighting, morale to help fighting, just general fighting. Maybe I should be using, perhaps... infantry combat ability, perhaps, or cavalry combat ability, but generally I find in the end, when you have so many units in a province anyway, whoever wins the morale war wins the war. Whoever breaks first loses. So hopefully we get our mega stack and defeat their mega stack. Anyway, you can feel free to criticize me for my idea choices and suggest what I should do next time, but this seemed, I guess, good enough for 50 points. And that's our costs there. We've saved some points by being a duchy, we've saved some points by having a really bad heir, we've spent 1.3 points on our starting province, and we've started with these skill, like, a slightly skilled ruler and some national ideas. Anyway, let's go. And now we find out whether we won the New World roulette and have something right there to colonize. And we did. So this is why I played with Random New World, because of this. Whoa, lost Serbia and lost Bosnia. This is already a very interesting game. So just before I go, I just wanted to go through the main advantages of randomizing the New World, because I don't think I explained them properly to you before. So, as you can see, by randomizing the New World, we could luck out and get an island that's very close to Reykjavik. And this island is actually so close that as soon as we get Exploration 3, like the third idea in Exploration, we'll be able to colonize all the provinces on the east here. Because that will boost our colonial range to 240, and that is 222, and there's a 209 and a 210 colonial range provinces. So we'll be able to easily jump in and colonize this island. When, if we were playing with historical, then we'd have to colonize Greenland, and Greenland's a bit more west, and by the time you can actually colonize the western side of Greenland, where these two provinces are on Greenland, you can actually jump all the way to Canada. So Greenland actually gives you no advantage, and you actually have to tech up for several decades, like you have to wait several decades to get the tech that allows you to even get to these Greenland provinces. Historical New World, with the shape of Brazil and South America, really advantages Portugal and Castile, and we want to try to curtail as much as possible the advantages, the natural geographic advantages that those two are going to get. They're going to be colonizing a lot of the New World anyway. We want to get there first, or get first dibs on as much of it as possible. Also, these random little islands and stepping stones will be able to easily take and kind of cut off England and France from ever colonizing anywhere. Now, the main reason that I used to choose Randomized New World for this particular kind of playthrough is that all of the New World will be in one continent. So instead of the several continents that the New World is broken up into in a historical New World, where you will thus have distant overseas penalties, say if you moved your capital to North America, then South America and Central America and the Caribbean will be considered distant overseas and you won't get the full benefit of those provinces. All of the New World will all be in one continent and thus will not be overseas, and you'll get the full advantage of those provinces. However, the states and territories mechanic that was introduced a patch or two ago probably removes all of that advantage, and I've heard from some friends that it's really a kick in the teeth for colonial powers. And I mean, we can just look at the areas here. So each area is going to be a territory or a state eventually, and so we have a limit of states, which currently is 10 states limit. So that means we can only really have 10 areas where we're getting the full benefit, like 100% of the base tax and manpower from. And all the others are going to be territories where we, I think, get 75% or 50% of the base tax and manpower, and that's really going to be annoying. Especially because a state in Europe, if we look at the areas, Europe, I mean, sure, Europe is a lot more kind of segmented in terms of states. The states aren't as large, but each of those states has really good provinces in it, like three good provinces in Europe, especially in kind of Germany or France. Three provinces in Germany and France are going to be worth a lot more than any area in the New World is going to be. So, being limited to 10 states may actually be something that we're really going to have to work around when we're playing this game. But anyway, that's part of the fun. Anyway, I'll see you next video.